Cool Deep has come up with an improved version of the pantorouter with a tilting table. And in this video, I'll show you how it goes together. The base of it consists of these aluminum extrusions, and I've already attached some of the brackets to these. The parts attach with these slots with nuts that slide in the slots. So I've got two nuts here, which are for one of these shaft holders. And when you put the shaft holders in, make sure that the screw is facing the inside, which will make it much easier to attach the shaft later. And I'm tightening these just so that they're a little bit snug so it doesn't slide around on its own. These three pieces need to be in this orientation, and then they attach to the side rails, and these have got some holes drilled out here. All these holes face to the bottom, and the part with a line on it on this side goes here. This is the shorter distance, this is the longer distance here. There's a screw with a washer in every one of the holes in here, and here I've got the square nut, and now I can slide this on, again holes towards the bottom. And I have to make sure that the washers are in the slot. There's holes in the rails which allows me to reach through with an Allen key and tighten up those screws. I've got to make sure that the corners are flush, and this line has to line up with the edge of this part here, and then the screws will line up in here too. And for these angle brackets, it's best to snug the two screws first and only then tighten them up so that we don't end up forcing some kind of skew on it. Now it's important that this distance in here is exactly 90 millimeters. And without calipers, we can just use some of these parts because these are 60 by 30. So if I put them in like so, that makes a 90 millimeter spacing and I can make sure I have the alignment correct. And you can also use these blocks to make sure that these parts on here are flush. Now is the best time to attach the rubber feet. It won't get any easier, and having the feet on there actually makes some of the other steps go faster. Next comes the supports for the table, and these consist of these L-shaped ones facing outwards here and here. And these two pieces here, and this bar across. These all attach with screws from the bottom. And this is why it's important to have these drilled holes facing down so we can get the screws in there. Now the distance at the top of these also needs to be 90 millimeters, and if you don't have calipers, you can use these two rails, and this is another one that's 60 wide, and just check the spacing in here, and back here, it's a bit tight, so I need to loosen the screws and slide this back a little bit. Cool Deep says sometimes it may help to flip it like this, or like this to get that spacing right. Now I can attach the angle adjust mechanism, and it goes on like this so the table can be attached to the top. And there's a bearing which has got a slightly wider flange that needs to be facing towards the machine, and there needs to be a washer that goes against it so that we don't lock the bearing when we screw it on. And it goes on with a screw like this, and it screws onto here. This part should swing freely even after you tighten the screw. Now I can put the angle lock knob in here, and this is why the distance in here is so important, because otherwise this will bind in the slot here. Before I put the lock knob on here, I need to insert the little square nuts in here for my angle indicator pointer. Now I can attach the tabletop, and there's some screw threads here and here. To set the table exactly horizontal, there's no adjustable stop in here. All we need is for this to come to rest on here. Now, if you buy the non-tilting version of the pantorouter, this is much simpler because the table just screws onto the ends of these things. There's none of these parts exist because these things here are just long enough that the table can bolt directly onto them. Now I'll put the base aside and work on the pantograph mechanism. Now we have to attach the linear bearings to the bottom of the pantograph base. It's a good idea to insert the rod in the bearings before tightening them down, just to make sure that they're actually aligned with each other. Now we need to assemble the template holder frame, which is made out of these three pieces, and it goes on here. The frame goes together with these interesting fasteners here. We need to loosen these a little bit, and then these knobs fit into the slot on here, and just by tightening the screws again, this thing locks together rigidly. Now it's important to get the orientation right. There's some screw threads on this end, which goes towards the bottom, and then there's a hole here, and that hole needs to face this way. There's a reinforcing bracket that goes on this side where the operating handle is, and that screws onto this part here. This will be used for the depth stop later, so we might as well put that in now. This part here will later hold the plunge depth scale, and I'm adding that now because it'll be more difficult to get on there later. I've just loosened the four shaft mounts so that now when I put the pantograph mechanism in, I can slide these back and forth to make them mate with the linear bearings in the actual pantograph base. Now I have to make sure I have it aligned like this, and the easiest way to do that is just to slide this forward and make this touch both sides and make sure the corners are flush with the edges, and then we have it in the right position, and I can tighten where the shafts are. Now I'd advise tightening down just one shaft initially, and that way you can slide the carriage towards the mounts when tightening those, just to make sure those are all at exactly the right spacing. And we also need to lock the shafts in place by tightening the little screws on the mounts. Next comes the plunge lever, and that pivots on here and mounts to a hole here. And that's mounted with this little bracket here. Now that goes on with a square nut in the slot. And this bracket here, countersink on the front, threaded part on the back. And it just screws down. And then the lever goes in here. And that attaches to the template holder with a screw in here. And there's a thread on the back link. And so we just make that a little bit snug and then put the nut on the back to tighten it. Now we need to add the depth stops on here. And these are these two L-shaped brackets. Now there's long ones and short ones. The short ones are used for depth stops. And we need to slide the nut in from the end. And we have an adhesive backed scale, and that needs to go on so that the zero is exactly lined up with this edge here. This part is the template holder, and it's got a protective backing on it, which is kind of hard to get started. The template holder mounts to these pieces of brass, and it gets mounted on there with some spacers. These tiny little things here, and those go around the holes, like so. The brass bars insert into the slots on the template holder frame, and these keep it nice and parallel, and then to lock the vertical position, there's a bolt that goes in here, and a knob and a washer goes on the back. Now if you're using a really big template, like this separately sold dovetail template, the heads of the bolts actually interfere with the template. So for that, you take out these bolts here, and then there's a separate set of depth locking little knobs that go on here. And that way you can still lock the height of the template without having to put the knobs in the bolt heads here. The holes on here are 1-inch spacing, and there's various templates that can be screwed onto here, either purchased ones or homemade ones. And depending on what size of follower and what size of router bit you use, you can use the same template to cut out several different sizes of tenon. And to cut the mortise, we just flip this thing around and put the shaft in here, and now we can use this to cut mortises. The router fits in here, but before you try to insert it, you have to loosen these screws way up in here because it can be a very tight fit, and it helps to smear a little bit of oil in here because that makes the router slide a little bit easier. Now, to position stock on here repeatedly, there's these two things which can be used as stops mounted on the table. And lock these in place. But for cutting mortises, we actually need to position the workpiece at the edge of the table. So these things here can also be used as a stop for that by flipping the screw around. And we slide the nut into here, and then screw the stop on like so. And that makes for a shallow ledge here that we can push the stock up against. Now to hold down the stock, we have various options. For some applications, we can just put a clamp over the edge like this. Or we could make a homemade hold down using a bolt and a wing nut or a plastic knob, and just tighten that on here. A 5/16 or M8 carriage bolt, like this one, with two sides ground flat works really well in the slots. Or you could buy one of those clamps from Festool. Or you could order your pantorouter with these self-adjusting Bessie clamps.